Today we have two young, amazing, talented drummers with two amazing bands that are out at the moment. Gerry Morgan, currently working with James Bay, and Eddy Thrower, out with Lower Than Atlantis. So thanks guys for joining us today.
Thanks for having us.
It's very exciting. It's nice to have people my age.
This is what I get. Look at it.
I have a question for both of you, in that you both came out of music college. What are the advantages and the disadvantages?
You're going to let me have this one?
Yes, I think.
Okay. Advantages, like, well, for me anyway, it was just meeting people.
Where did you study?
Southampton. Right, music of Academy and Sound.
Oh, lovely.
I had to think about that one then. Yeah, music
Such
of Academy
a
and Sound.
Ago.
Yeah, basically meeting people is like one of the best things kind of I ever did. Like my drum tech now is my best friend that I met on that course, who's an amazing drummer as well. Because before that I didn't really know many people within like the music industry, or not necessarily the industry, but just kind of playing instruments. And as soon as I joined that course, I just met a ton of people straight away, made friendships and started playing with different musicians, different types of musicians. And that's one of the advantages by far. Yeah. Yeah. What about you?
Same thing.
Yeah?
Yeah. No, I think...
Where did you go, Jerry?
I studied initially in Goldsmiths in London, and then...
Oh, that's a posh one.
Yeah, it was posh, it was... Yeah, it was very arty. And the course was very young at the time, so I think the course was trying to find its feet as well. But then I stopped that and went on tour for a while, and then finished in Lippa in Liverpool, which was a great change of scenery from London, Southeast London to Liverpool. But I enjoyed both, but both had, you know, each had its different sort of advantages and disadvantages.
So what would you say are the disadvantages of?
I don't know, for me, like, a lot of people get complacent and think like doing that course is gonna get you like this dream job in the music industry, or get even your band like signed, because a lot of people think getting signed is like the be all or end all.
But a lot of people just end up signing on, you know?
Yeah,
I mean?
Yeah.
There's very little like...
Exactly.
Kind of, I think, in my experience, there's very little kind of career guidance.
Yeah.
Whenever you're sort of just, you learn loads of music, learn to play, and then off you go. Anyway,
yeah.
That was my experience.
Yeah, same with me, to be honest. And I think a lot of people think when that course finishes, you're just going to suddenly get this job. But in reality, that's not what happens, really. So I think that's one of the disadvantages by far. Mm. Like, just people thinking, that's it. Like, do that course and you're going to be a musician.
But then there's a lot of guys and girls that never studied formally that are completely, you know, cleaning up. Mm. You know, it's just sort of a natural self-development that, you know, that maybe they didn't have any guidance from teachers or a course, but they source their own kind of stuff, you know, to learn, but they just don't have the crippling debt that we do.
Do you think maybe there's an advantage in private lessons, tuitions?
Yeah,
absolutely.
More than the schools? Or
I think so. I think it's good for when you're young to have like achievable goals, like grading systems and stuff. I think that's very good for teenagers starting out. Because, you know, teenager needs some sort of guidance to like slow down the crazy, you know, sporadicness of their mind. Mm. You know, so I think some sort of syllabus is good for the young mind, at least.
It just depends who your teachers are as well. Like, private tuition is good. Mm. But if you've got some guy who just doesn't really teach you what you need to know and just puts on AC/DC for an hour and takes 60 quid out of your hand, like, you're not going to learn anything.
60 quid, wow.
Well, like, when I was younger, I used to pay about 40 quid, I think, and this was like years ago, and I used to kind of just sit there and get like play along to AC/DC and then leave, because I was a kid and I was playing drums, I was loving it, but I wasn't benefiting from it.
No. So something I think you could have done in the house on your own.
Exactly, yeah. So I think, because I teach sometimes, and that's why I like to think, you know, you've got, it's good to play along to tracks, and especially with like musicians as well, but you've got to tell people and learn what you actually need to, it sounds really obvious, but learn the stuff that's needed. Content. Yeah.
The industry, yeah.
Yeah.
Gerry, I think we've got a little video clip of you playing with James.
Let's roll it.
Okay. Okay, let's just roll it, okay? So I've seen the band. That's Let It Go, isn't it?
That's correct.
Okay. And I've seen the gig.
Yes.
And I've got to say that you were excellent.
Thank you very much.
Not because you're on the show, but you really were. You were multitasking big time.
Yeah.
There was drums, percussion while you're playing drums, and singing backing vocals.
Yeah.
The whole thing. Is that something you've done just for this James Bay gig, or is it something you've always been interested in?
I think it's been brought together to the extreme, if you know what I mean, for this gig, because on the album there was a lot of percussion layering and lots of drum layering and stuff, and that's kind of what I had to recreate live to sort of make sense of it. So I had to sort of discover a way of playing several different parts at the same time. But I've always played percussion and drums, bit of a drumushinist.
Yeah, you're a bit of a collector as well.
Yeah.
Aren't you?
Yeah.
Learning.
You don't read?
No.
But you're also a collector of percussion, aren't you? You go around...
When I'm touring, I go around and buy the strangest percussion instruments, and everyone in the crew and the band sort of get annoyed because I come back with this...
Like what?
...monstrosity, and they just go, what the f*** is that? The strangest one I came back with was in Portland, and it was a percussion fiddle. Yep. And it's just... Have you seen those things?
I've never seen that, ever.
It's just like a large stick with random stuff on it, but it's got like a spring, it's got like two sort of tart tins almost with loads of like seeds in it, and it's got wood blocks and like a boat bell, a sea bell, and you stomp it and you scrape it and you ding it and you wood block it,
flick it. Yeah.
And you give it a good flick.
Yeah.
So does James, do you just bring this stuff onto stage and start playing, or just...
No, of course not.
You can't.
But some things, you know, like Peruvian seed shakers have been and gone, and like my goat's toes on that gig, and my full moon tambourines, and then just several times. I think there's like four or five tambourines in the gig, which is kind of strange to think. And just it's African shakers and normal shakers. What else do I want to introduce a tongue drum.
Okay.
Into this scenario, because I've bought a couple of them recently.
Yeah.
And I really like the sort of tuned element.
On that video clip, you weren't using the 24. That's just the single bass drum. But on the gig...
I think that was a fly-out gig, so I didn't...
On the gig, you're using a
20,
bass drum.
Yeah, 24, 22, but not in the sort of...
Double bass drum.
Yes, not in the kind of rockier or heavier side of things. Because I would just use double kick drum pedals.
For that open.
It's
sound.
The open kind of sound. It's the texture. It's that tone that's on the record. So I want to play instead of playing an SBDS or something. I want to have that sort of organic rootsy approach because I think it's sort of.
Yeah, if you can, you might as
well. Absolutely, and I think that's where James came from on his record as well. So, I don't think there should be any triggering or. On this gig, anyway.
Yeah, no, I thought it was great. Love the gig. Eddy, so let's talk about your band, London Atlantis. How did that come about?
The band were going whilst I was in another band. Me and Decker from Winchester, like down south, and we played in like a heavier band, like a metal band pretty much. And then toured with LTA when they had their old members. And then, they just got rid of their old members and just Mike just gave me a shout on Facebook. I was delivering Indian at the time, I think, like Chinese and all
delivering
that.
Food.
Yeah, yeah.
Nice.
Just with my mates.
You didn't have a little moped, did
nah,
you?
No, in a car, yeah. And yeah, just sent me a message like, are you up for it? And I was like, yeah, cool. Sacked that band off because it wasn't really going anywhere. And then a couple of months after that, that's when it kind of kicked off, really. You've got management and all that kind of stuff and started putting in the hard work. We all just quit our jobs, started playing to like two people. I remember Aberdeen, we played. So there was one paying customer and he had to leave halfway through. So it was pretty, and at that point, and I think after that, I called my dad up and I was like, Dad, can you sort us out some pizzas? Like, come on, we didn't get a rider. We got stiffed on that. And he was like, yeah, okay, but what are you doing? Come on, what are you doing?
Come on, son, what are you doing?
Well, yeah, we just put in the hard work in it, and it's kind of like.
What was the venue in Aberdeen?
I can't remember. I think it was like the Tunnels or something.
Oh, the Tunnels.
I think
Yeah. That's grim, isn't it?
Yeah.
But a great music venue for local Aberdeen drummers.
Yeah. One person loves it.
From Aberdeen, yeah.
Mate, they don't have anything techno.
Yeah, but so that was it.
Places by the sound of it.
No, not at all.
Yeah, but yeah, we just.
Now the band because the band have written, or a few of the guys have written big songs for other bands as well, haven't they? And
We write all of our own music anyway. Mike writes for, he's done a 5 Seconds of Summer song. Mm. He's done a few other things as well. But yeah, we just, on the last album, we started working with different people and meeting different producers and stuff. And that's when the kind of songwriting and my session work kind of just, yeah, started really.
Yeah,
we started meeting loads of new people, but yeah.
Okay, Jill.
Talking point.
Yes, your talking point.
What's your talking point?
Is it about chewing gum?
No. I know we're not going to talk about chewing gum. So my talking point today is about the drum community as a whole. Mm-hmm. Being two young people up and coming who are having basically their breakouts.
Thank you very much for calling me young as well.
You're welcome.
Something that's not going to last for too much longer.
Well, no, he's 76 now.
I am, yeah. But I moisturise a lot.
Yeah.
And work out.
I want to talk about the importance of the drumming community because from my point of view, it's a very unique community that is shared basically worldwide compared to other instruments where you look at pianist players or guitarists. Everyone seems to be very supportive and they always go out and see other people play. They're always having, any time I sit with drummers, it's all they talk about.
Yeah. Sessions.
Yeah.
I'm going to come over and share.
Yeah.
I want to get your opinion on the importance of it and to kind of give advice to those who are up and coming in how it can help them.
Sorry, what was the question?
Well, first of all, it's not about shred.
Does Eddie remember my question, and then Gerry can remember?
Yeah, yeah.
It's still a bright colour, but they're like.
Yeah, it is important. No, I've completely forgotten the question now. You're throwing me off, sorry, man.
Drumming community, how important is it?
Very important.
It is important. I'd just recently, with social media these days, you can talk to anyone.
Yes.
And you don't even need to meet them. Like, for example, Kaz Rodriguez, you know Kaz?
Yeah.
Spoke to him online for like months and months, just chatting about, good work on this, this sounds cool. Let's meet up soon. Found out he lived around the corner from me.
Oh, great.
So he came down to our studio and we just played drums. And it wasn't like, that was the first time I've done it, but it wasn't like, let's see what you've got kind of thing.
Yeah.
It was just more of just hanging out and chatting. We did more talking, we did playing drums really. Went till about 9 till 4 in the morning, like just hanging out and just like sharing each other's stories and experience and like, how did you get that? How did you do that? Because he kind of thought like, he didn't know much about my band and thought it was a kind of session gig or whatever, didn't realise I've been in it from the start. So it's all just about sharing stories, and it is important because that's how you learn.
I know you, Gerry, with Johnny Colgan.
Yes, I know Johnny.
You know Johnny you grew up with, and I think he's now walked into some of the gigs, the Hudson gig that you did before.
Yeah.
I think that probably came through you anyway, didn't it?
It did, yeah. And, you know, I suppose it's just helping other people out, friends out and stuff. And
And I think that's what Jill's saying, you know, in maybe in other instruments that doesn't maybe
no,
they're like, yeah, no, don't use that guy.
Yeah.
You know, where
it's a very more cutthroat, I find. You're a bit more critical of each other, whereas you guys seem to be very supportive.
All buddies.
It's like that in like bands as well. Like bands who you know, have a lot to prove and like a lot to work for, it's kind of like dog eat dog, really. It's kind of like...
I sort of have an analogy on that, to be honest. As I've got older, I've always thought that as a musician in the band, the drummer's always the one that probably gets the least credit, sits at the back.
Yeah.
I'm not saying does it all, but holds everything together, and is quite happy just to sit there and, you know, let all the other egos go. So when we get together as drummers, it's quite nice because we're all like, we can all...
We're so oppressed.
Yeah, that's right. So it's always been my analogy of it. Let all the guitarists and the singers, take all the praise.
Yeah.
You know, you just stand, you sit the back there and you shake your shakers.
I shake my shit.
What advice would you give to people who are up and coming and wanting to try and, you know, meet people?
What, drummers?
Yeah, and try and meet other people, like go out to gigs.
We don't talk about the other ones.
I think, as you said, you know, reach out in any way possible.
Yeah.
Social media. Going to jam nights, find out where people are playing, just go and say hello.
Yeah.
Because people are, you know, you might look at a certain artist or musician and of course they're on some sort of pedestal because they're like, you know, on an album or something, but everyone's just a normal person trying to get by and be expressive, make music and pay your bills and everyone's got the same issues and, you know, same problems and everyone's just trying to go forward. So it's kind of a very simple thing.
That's literally it. Like, just be creative. Be like, oh, do you want to get together and do this? It may work. It might not. Like, get together. Like, even just get together and just like, you know, record an Instagram video, 15 seconds. I don't know. Do anything. Just use your mind and just don't be a dick. Really,
that's
be
a
nice
one.
Guy.
Don't be a dick.
It's right. True. Like, you meet too many people, and I've met too many people that just. You end up walking away going, oh,
he's a dick.
Well, he was a dick.
Yeah.
And I feel like bummed out and I don't want to do that. I don't want to approach him. And now he's put me off approaching other people.
Yeah.
That's true.
But just you be a nice guy.
And open.
Yeah.
I mean, I think this is again something that we've seen a lot through the shows. You know, if you're out on the road with guys and you've been out with James for 2 years, if you were a dick, as you like to, you know, you're not going to keep that gig. Don't matter how good your drums is.
Yeah.
Someone else can come in and do that.
Absolutely.
They may not have all those weird and wonderful percussion items.
I can lend them though.
Yeah, exactly.
Because we're a big community.
There you go.
Have some of my percussion.
Well, I think we should go over to our commercial break.
Yeah, we should.
Okay, so let's have a look.
The badge had to represent what we are and what we do. So it's a combination of ornate. It's an ornate badge, but in the badge there's a message to build and excel, and to inspire and enhance. And that's exactly what, you know, our drums do. So people would ask, what makes a good drum? Well, it's everything that makes a good drum, and it's the small detail from A to Z. It's the timber type. It's the gluing of the timber, the cutting. The lacquer, the edges, the lugs, the heads, the hoops, everything goes together and makes that product. And if it's all good, it's like baking, you get out what you put into it, you know, all the good ingredients, and that's what makes a good drum.
This is it. Okay, boys. So, look, rubbing of hands. Should we be worried?
Yeah.
Huh?
So it's show and tell time.
Ooh.
Okay. Yeah. Ooh. Jerry's just swallowed his chewing gum.
Yeah.
Okay. So let's start with you, Jerry.
Okay. Well,
what have you got for show and tell?
I've got a lucky hat, but it's not this hat.
Ah. Okay.
But it was given to me by the President of Ireland about 2 years ago, because I gave his son a drum lesson for free because it was the President of Ireland. Okay. And it was a really beautiful sort of experience because the kid, you know, the kid had no arms, so it was really difficult to teach him. But I managed to teach him a pretty straight rock beat just using his feet. And I think the president was kind of really just impressed. So he just says, here, this is mine. I want you to have it. And it's Donegal tweed as well. Which is, you know. You
can but what was the real reason you got the hat?
That was it. The real reason is that I forgot about this section of the show.
Okay, so Eddy, let's see what you've got.
I just can't top that. I just can't top
you've
that.
You've got to top you it.
Just take it on a journey.
Okay.
Wow.
Mine seems really boring now, but I just bought a pair of Travis Barker's sticks.
That's cool.
Okay.
Yeah, for many reasons, really.
Love the colour.
Yeah.
Colour's good.
Yeah.
Starting.
Yeah, normally they come in white, actually. I don't know why these are black.
Oh.
But yeah, Travis Barker got me into drums, basically. Okay. Blink-182 are one of my favourite bands. And we were lucky enough to actually play three shows with them, do a little mini tour.
Oh, wow.
Which is cool. And a few days before that, actually, we went to watch them in Cardiff, I think it was. Yeah. And we all got to meet them, which for me is Travis Barker, Dave Grohl, and a few other people. They're the kind of people you meet, and what do you say? Yeah. What they're the reason I play drums. So it was kind of a hard thing. But
what did you say?
Well, we were in Mark's dressing room, and our manager at the time was like, okay, cool, Travis is ready for you. I was like, wicked, come on, boys. And she was like, no, it's just you. And I was like, oh.
He wants a shed.
Yeah, this is ridiculous. Yeah, he wants a shed, yeah. Show up some chops. So I knocked in his room and it was just all of his entourage were there and it was just the most intimidating situation I've ever been in.
He has a lot of entourage.
Yeah, he had Bounce's family and all that lot. And I was so everyone's looking at me, staring at me, what do I say? Anyway, I managed to kind of break the ice. But he showed me his gym that he had in his dressing room, showed me his electric kit set up. Yeah.
He's got a gym in the dressing room.
Yeah. It's kind of what I remember anyway. It was treadmill, bike, a few dumbbells, mat.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's quite normal for us drummers to really have gyms.
Yeah.
A treadmill and
I don't have a treadmill, but I've got
dumbbells.
Dumbbells, and I've got some medicine balls just for to work out the core. A couple of yoga mats. What do you use?
I don't use yoga mats.
Do you not?
Nah.
Just
like the dumbbells that we spoke about earlier.
The same thing.
Yeah. Yeah.
This is going to go painfully wrong with this. So you've got no treadmill or bike in your room as well then?
No, I have no treadmill, but I've got dumbbells and stuff like that and yoga mats.
Okay.
Yeah. Just like Travis B.
Yeah, just like him.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Wow.
Basically I use these as well to warm up with because they're thicker. I take these everywhere with me, all around the world, tour. Not these specific ones.
Right. The white ones.
The white ones, yeah.
Is it true about Travis Barker, that unfortunate story that he can't fly?
Yes. Yeah, he gets the boat everywhere. Yeah.
That's mad, isn't it? That's crazy.
Because of a fire.
Yes.
That
was really unfortunate, but that's really
difficult.
I have
to tell you a quick story then. If you're a fan of Travis Barker, and you can go on camera, a few years back, a young lad in the UK died of cancer, drummer, Jordan, and I did a run, and Nick Mason had given me a signed symbol of Pink Floyd, signed symbol to do this run, and we charitied it off, and we raised some money.
Uh-huh.
And I vowed at the end of the marathon, that was it. It was the most worst experience of my life.
Yeah.
I was never doing it again.
Fair
Travis
play, though.
Got in contact with me, because he found out that this young lad, Jordan, was a huge Travis Barker fan, and said, I've got this symbol that I've just recorded the last album on.
Yeah.
I'd love to donate it for you to do another marathon for you to decide to do another marathon.
Fair play, though.
But good.
That's good.
That's really good.
I've got quite a few symbols outside if you want to do
a few
more
marathons.
No,
I'm not doing any more marathons. Thank you very much, sir. Thank you for that. But it seems you're so fit.
Yes, I'll do it.
You're doing all those workouts. Well,
you don't have a treadmill in your dressing room, do you? You only got dumbbells.
Yeah, but it's all right. You can only do half a marathon. It'd be fine.
Yeah.
Yeah. Anyway, right, okay.
You do a lot of gym workout, though. I see on Twitter a lot of your Twitter updates for just being at the gym.
Yeah, well, not as much as Eddie's doing at the moment. Okay, so it's...
We're really wanting to move on
now. We better move on now.
No, I think we should talk about this.
Okay, guys, can we get your attention while you're doing your fashion? So this is Use It or Lose It.
Yes.
Okay, and this item is called the kick strap.
Great.
Now... Shall I talk about it first, or are you going to tell us a bit more about the...
Do you want me to just give you highlights?
Yeah, give me some highlights and then
okay,
I'll explain.
Okay, so the kick strap is... the bass drum strap is an innovative solution to stop the bass drum creep. It doesn't require any carpet. It keeps the bass drum in place, and yes, it can be played on any surface. It was actually created by Gary Benson in the 90s.
Yes, right.
Gary Benson actually runs a drum shop in America.
Oh, right. Where is that?
No, don't start asking me trick questions.
Oh, no, it wasn't. Okay. I was just wondering.
But what it has got is it's got different lips, yes, on the different colour ones, so that the different... So basically, the bass drum pedal will slide into there.
Yeah.
Okay, so the different lips are obviously the different bass drum. And then that will slide onto the rim of the bass drum, and then obviously you can strap that onto.
Uh-huh.
And they come in three colours, yellow, red, and pink.
Yeah.
Pink one's for you, Eddy. So, boys, what do you think?
It's going to be hard to lose it, the colour.
I'm going to come out there and say lose it.
You're going to lose it?
Yeah.
Why?
I just think... I don't know. I just don't think I'd ever need it. I don't think...
It's because you're big time now. So you got a drum tech and carpet.
You're big time.
If you're doing a little gig down the Dog and Duck Saturday night...
Come on.
But most of those venues have got sticky floors anyway, because all the snake bite on the floor. So it's
chewing gum. We're chewing gum.
Yeah, they just flick it and don't bin
just
it.
Flick it. Yeah.
So bad. But I just don't think. Yeah, I think most of the bass drums these days anyway are quite.
So what does this bit go to?
Rubber on
that
it.
That bit goes onto the bottom of the drum stool. So there's your drum stool.
Who would play their kick drum that close?
Well, it depends. If
maybe
that
like
little kid
really
that you
short.
Taught in in Ireland might play because he's got no arms. That might have been a bit, but you know it can adjust.
Yeah, but even still, that's too short a distance.
That is pretty.
You think that's still too short?
Yeah. I think that's pretty short.
Well, wouldn't it not go under the leg? This would be under the leg.
The first leg.
Yeah, and that would be the bass drum.
That would be the front of the kick drum.
Yeah,
that's still too short for a kick drum.
Okay, so you wouldn't use it.
No, I would lose that.
You'd lose it?
Mm.
Okay. Well, as you can guess, everybody, these are very fun guests who don't take a lot of stuff very seriously. So I have idea
it is.
What is going to happen on this 1 minute with.
No, it's the bright colours, man. Don't put bright colours in front of them.
It's true.
Let's take a look at this recorded section of 1 minute with. Good luck, Jill.
Thanks. All right, here we are, 1 minute with. I've got Gerry with me now. Are you ready?
Yes.
And your favourite record performance that you played on?
Record performance? I don't know. Have I played any records?
All right, let's try again. The drummer you first saw that made you want to start?
I think it was... I don't know.
Okay.
No, it was definitely someone like that wanted me to start as a kid. It was probably the guy that ended up teaching me, because that's who I sort of saw first of all, you know.
Yeah.
Tommy Thomas, guy from Northern Ireland.
Okay. First record you ever bought?
Oh, I think it was something horrible, like Scooter or something really bad like that.
What is your favourite all-time album?
That's also a difficult question because there's so many. I'm really liking John Martin's Solitaire at the moment.
Buddy or Ringo?
Buddy.
And that's your 1 minute with.
That was really difficult.
Next 1 minute with, I've got Eddy with me now. Are you ready?
Ready.
Your favourite record performance that you've played on?
My band's last album.
The drummer you first saw that made you want to start?
Travis Barker.
Favourite live venue you've played in?
Coco.
First record you ever bought?
Metallica.
Last record you ever bought?
Justin Bieber.
Favourite all-time movie?
The Truman Show.
An artist dead or alive, would you like to have worked with?
Stevie Wonder.
Flight or tour bus?
Tour bus.
Favourite book?
Don't read books.
Favourite holiday vacation?
LA.
Favourite, if you were not a musician, what would you do?
Work for musicians.
What's important to you as an artist in one word?
Creativity.
Favourite all-time album?
That's proper hard. Pass.
With chewing gum, bin or bush? No, always. I can't say that. I can't. What have you done?
What?
What have you got on your... They're sharing the hats shirt. Around. Yeah.
It is a hat shirt.
Yeah, it's a hat shirt. I think, we're all family. It's a community here.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
Gerry's answers were very thoughtful for the 1 minute with. I think he needed more time. But they were very thoughtful. I thought they were very, very thoughtful.
Okay.
I'm a very thoughtful person. I've got a good heart.
You're from Ireland, of course you have.
Yes, I am.
Okay, so we're coming towards the end of the show. I want to talk about a couple of things. First of all, have been doing some interesting YouTube videos recently. Can you explain the one that we're going to see now, first of all?
Yeah, this is like my kind of first like YouTube cover sort of thing. It's really... I kind of put it off doing it for a while just because I think there's so many of them out there and so many of them are rubbish, if I'm being honest. Like, I think a lot of them are kind of just overly triggered drums and people miming to them, doing stick twirls and chucking them up in the air. And that's not really my sort of thing. So I wanted to do a drum video that's kind of just one take, no click, improv, see how it turns out. And I did a Kendrick song. I love Kendrick, man. I think he's absolutely amazing. So yeah, I've got my friend to film it, Jordan Green, who comes on tour with us and does all the photography and stuff. Ben and our band recorded it.
Should we have a look at it?
Yeah, let's have a look at it. Everybody that covered it, how many times my position was anonymous? How many times the city making me promises? So I promise this. I love myself.
Shot that in your studio?
In our studio in Watford.
That's your studio, okay,
cool. We've
That's very good.
Cheers, man.
So do you play that amount of chops on your gigs?
No, never.
Okay, so you're just chopping out.
Yeah.
Shedding.
Yeah, shedding out. Yeah. I mean, like, you've got to do it to a, like, it depends what you're, what kind of thing you're in, really. But like, when it comes to live, for me, it's not what you play, it's how you play it, like simple 4/4 beat, just playing back. You can tell within 5 seconds if someone's a good drummer or not, but I wanted to do a bit of both as well, and that's why I kind of just did that video, really.
Right.
But I'm doing more, so these ones are going to be less choppy and more just groove. But LTA stuff's groove based as well, so
I'd love to start doing.
I was just going to say, was this something that you would think about doing?
I would love to do that, but it's just getting the space and kind of.
That's the thing, yeah. You know. I always wanted to do it for years and years. So many like big YouTube drummers these days. Yeah. It's mental, but
it's very important, I think.
We've got our own studio now.
Why do you think it's important, Jerry?
I think it's good. It's just good to let people kind of let people aware of who you are, you know, musically. Or it's a reference as well. For if anyone's looking for a drummer, well, I don't know the guy, but what's he like? You know, well, this is what he's like for this kind of style of music.
But do you not find that? I mean, obviously, I've seen both of your bands live. When I came to see you live the other day, obviously, if you were going out there and playing a chopped video, if you like, would that?
No, it wouldn't be on the gigging plan.
But I do putting that kind of stuff out.
Well, yeah, because when I get the time to practice, I do work through rudiments and linear phrasings and stuff and orchestrate them around the kit in different ways. Right. So I do play choppy behind my closed doors, but I'm not on a gig that. You know, requires that or wants that. If I did that kind of playing on my gig at the moment, it would just be wrong.
Yeah.
Yeah. So that never happens.
Yeah, it's all about just playing for the music. As cliche as that sounds.
But it's the truth.
Yeah, man. Exactly.
If you don't play the song, you don't.
Yeah.
Like, why are you there then?
Yeah.
You know, it's very important.
Well, I'm sure you'd agree with me. They've been wonderful,
amazing.
Entertaining,
immature
guests.
Immature, probably.
No, I wouldn't say immature. I'd say you've been,
insightful.
I feel like I'm the father on the sofa, you know, keeping everything in check here. But, you know, that's cool. What do you mean, yes?
Well, if you, you know.
Token.
Yeah.
But
I was always told not to talk back, you know. So I'm just agreeing.
Well, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Cheers. For being our guest. Until next time, on behalf of myself and Jill, thank you, and see you later. Bye-bye.